So, truly more than a year ago, Lindsay Ellis made a video essay titled, Are Disney Villains Going Extinct? I saw it for the first time a couple weeks ago, and I have not been able to stop thinking about it since. I think that Lindsay makes a lot of good points, but I also think she overlooks a pretty crucial piece of the trajectory of Disney's animated movies, and that's technology. So this is my very, very, very belated video response, Disney Villains in Three Dimensions. Let's start with some context. Animation has always been deeply tied to technology, more so than probably any other form of filmmaking. Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs was as much an artistic accomplishment as it was a technical one, and Disney wasn't quiet about that.
This is the plan for a super cartoon camera. We call it the Multiplane Camera.
Their proprietary multiplane camera was part of the marketing for the film and for the studio in years to come, and Snow White was in a lot of ways the studio's victory lap in a multi-year race to determine whose animation technology would come out on top.
Each of these background planes is placed on one of the levels under the camera.
The multiplanar camera continued to be used for decades, whereas other tools like the Inkwell Studios setback camera were discontinued in the 1940s. There are other innovations throughout Disney's animation history, obviously. But for the purposes of this video, I'm going to divide Disney animation into three periods: traditional cel animation, digital 2D animation, and digital 3D animation. If you have mostly functioning eyes, you probably know what is digital 3D animation and what is not, but the difference between traditional cel and digital 2D is a bit harder to spot. Up until the 90s, all of Disney's animated movies were still inked and colored by hand. The Little Mermaid was the first Disney film where they used CAPS, or Computer Animation Production System, a software developed by Pixar that got rid of the need for traditional hand inking and painting. That means things like faces and backgrounds could handle a lot more detail, especially in terms of inked lines. You can see that by comparing the amount of detail in the Evil Queen's face to the amount of detail in, say, Jafar's. Okay, so this is all fine and interesting, but what does it have to do with villains? In Lindsay's video, the basic sketch of her claim is that Disney has shifted thematically from telling stories of good versus evil to telling stories about a hero's search for identity. Because of that, there are fewer good Disney villains. She's definitely right, but I think that there's more to it. I think that 3D digital animation, as Disney aestheticizes it, is fundamentally harder to craft iconic villains with.
Bleh. Blood, 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 and death.
All right, you know what, you're milking it.
Disney's most iconic villains lean hard into the strengths of traditional cel and digital 2D animation. They're all about points and lines. Especially in the Renaissance era, which is where many of Disney's most iconic villains come from, CAPS allowed animators to more easily cram as many lines and details as possible onto their villains' faces. Some of these lines, you're not even sure what they would look like in 3D. Like, what's happening here? It makes these characters look grotesque compared to their heroes. This is harder to do in three dimensions. You can't just add lines for emphasis when lines are by definition two-dimensional. Okay, so to really see what I'm talking about, let's look at the villain songs in Tangled and in The Little Mermaid. I think these films are pretty similar. In fact, I think that Mother Gothel is a better villain than Ursula. She has a compelling link to Rapunzel and has a clear external and internal motivation, and she's also just, like, super mean and abusive. Lindsay points out in her video that Mother Gothel is not a well-liked villain, but that's not because she's poorly written or tangential to the story. It's just because she's not iconic. So putting aside the fact that Poor Unfortunate Souls is a far superior song, visually a lot of the same things are happening in these two characters' villain songs. But while Ursula has so much more going on in her face compared to Ariel, Mother Gothel and Rapunzel are visually about equally interesting. There's one moment where Mother Gothel has a lot going on, and it just kind of looks like bad animation. It's not grotesque detail, it's just a weird image. Disney villains don't work as well in three dimensions. And this isn't just the case with Mother Gothel. The closest Disney has ever come to an iconic 3D villain is, I think, in their 2007 classic, Meet the Robinsons. This movie has some problems, mostly because it was made during a difficult time for the Walt Disney Animation Studios. But I think if it had come out today, Doris the Evil Hat would be a true 3D villain icon. If you're unfamiliar with the story, the villain in Meet the Robinsons is Mike Yagoobian, a hapless man-child who wants to get revenge on his childhood orphanage roommate who abandoned him when he grew up to be a famous inventor. Goob is scary at first, but the more we watch this big lug move around, the goofier he looks. His little legs and his ugly face just don't have the same weight or impact of other flatter Disney villains. And if he looked less goofy, he might be too scary for this movie's core demographic. So it makes sense that the story shifts the evil genius onto another character. We eventually find out that Goob has been taken advantage of by Doris, a vengeful hat invented by and then immediately shut down by Cornelius Robinson. And Doris is a great villain. She's super evil, but she also gets defeated way too quickly and is a hat. So I get why she's not hosting the Disney Villain Brunch. Part of the reason I think Doris works so well is because she has these sharp metal claws, and we see this device in another forgettable mid-aughts Disney movie, Chicken Little. Chicken Little is basically bad Lilo and Stitch. Both movies hinge on misunderstandings between an Earth community and invading aliens. But the difference is that while Lilo and Stitch aliens look sinister and cute at the same time, like the nuanced, multidimensional characters that they are, the Chicken Little aliens start out as scary robots, and then once we meet the fleshy lifeforms inside the robots, they turn out to be pure cuteness. Like, there's nothing menacing about them at all. Where 2D animation made great villains with lines and points, 3D animation can really only do that if it's mechanized. When it comes to life forms, it has to be about shape and texture and roundness. It's great for making cute things, which are not usually villains. And that doesn't just apply to Disney movies. On the whole, 3D family and children's animation has had to grapple with the changing strengths of their medium. Heck, the Despicable Me franchise is all about how cuddly villains can be when you make them round or three-dimensional. Shrek is too. Pixar movies tend to not have cut-and-dry villains either, or they have antagonists who don't show their true colors until the midpoint. I want to put The Incredibles aside because Syndrome is probably the best 3D digital villain of all time, and I think he's definitely iconic, but I would also argue that's more because of the superhero genre and less because of the medium. So the other two most notable villains in the traditional story sense for Pixar are probably Randall from Monsters, Inc., who we learn is actually very cute in the prequel, and the Grasshopper from A Bug's Life, who is scary and spiky in a way that's reminiscent of iconic 2D villains, but also in a way that kind of only works with the crude aesthetic of early 3D animation. Lindsay starts her essay by talking about how Moana doesn't have a real Disney villain, and that's definitely true. But I also think Moana does do some really interesting things to flatten out the more sinister characters. The use of darkness in the Tamatoa song makes him go from goofy, self-obsessed crab to scary, looming monster during Shiny. And although T'Ka turns out to just be Tefiti mourning her stolen heart, spoiler alert, T'Ka is one of the scariest 3D monsters I've seen in a Disney movie in years. She's covered in these harsh, detailed lines as magma flows between her cracked plates, and her overexposed facial features make her look both flatter and more dangerous. Which is just to say that I think it's possible for us to get iconic villains again with Disney's current tools and aesthetics. Disney villains are not doomed to extinction.
And death.
But what does that mean looking forward? Well, although it's been a year since Lindsay's initial video, we actually know even less now about Disney's future projects. Gigantic was their only slated original title last year, and it has since been shelved. The announced Disney titles to come are literally just Frozen 2, which could have a more conventional villain, but also could just be 2 hours of Olaf learning to swim. I have genuinely no idea. So here's my closing thought. If digital 2D animation lent itself to iconic villains, digital 3D animation lends itself to iconic cuties. It's all about round, malleable, cuddleable shapes. Most Disney 3D protagonists get an adorable childhood flashback, and they usually have at least one huggable sidekick, sometimes two, sometimes one and a half. But Disney hasn't ever really gone full Minions. I really racked my brain for a while, which is a very academically rigorous method, and I couldn't come up with a single analogous adorable army. No Penguins of Disney, which is interesting because even their sister studio has its Toy Story aliens. I don't know if that's an element of 3D animation that Disney will ever lean into as hard as Illumination has with their Minions, but it's an option. So based on absolutely nothing, my Frozen 2 villain prediction is an evil army of those Frozen Fever Snogies. Just imagine the merchandise. It sells itself. Call me Jennifer Lee.